I'll try to speak super, super loud thing, which I would for all of you. Hello, I'm John Paul. I'll give you more detail about me eventually. Thank you so much for the amazing introduction. I want to talk to you today. I heard implication that you might not be awake. I'm debating the whole life. If I had coffee I could throw at you, I would. If you want to do the whole like get up and shake it out thing, I won't hold anything against you at all. I know it is late in the afternoon. So I'm going to be talking to you today about Condé Nast's Path, Road, Long, Treacherous Path to PWAs, as well as how, at least from my perspective and in my opinion, very often I consider ourselves really building alien web applications and not quite what I see represented in the easiest path online. So I have a few questions. How many of you have heard of Condé Nast? Okay. Woo! Awesome. It's a New York thing. That's great. We will hear much more about this. So how many of you work every day with a single page application? Okay, great. That is great. So that means hopefully that a lot of this talk will be quite applicable. So Condé Nast is a large live company. We have 22 plus brands, depending on how you count acquisitions or not. Some of our, you can read them all here. We are built by, we have many, many different websites, all to produce editorial content. We are a publisher who makes interesting editorial articles and some journalism around quite a plethora of different topics. What I'm going to talk you through today is roughly our story, our narrative as to how we are starting to integrate with and build out more modern technology using progressive web app technology, using HTTPS, using all of the amazing things you've heard about for the past many, many hours, probably over lunch too. So the ones that you might have actually heard of in this list, so Wired obviously, Wired is a big one, especially for the tech people here. In case any of you want to talk to me about this afterward, Wired is the one with respect to PWAs that we are currently working on. I'll get into that in the future in a little bit. Also, and I think to give you a little bit of the flair for what we are all about and the shows we like to put on, we have Vogue, which, so this is actually the current homepage of Vogue. See how fancy we actually like to do it. You go to the homepage, there is a gigantic video above it. Can anyone guess who this is? I'm hearing a lot of no's, but you are right. It is Celine Dion. I was very surprised by this. When I first saw this, I took this screen cap. I took this screen capture and was like, who the hell is this woman? Yeah. And then I don't know if you actually caught it. I don't know if the person saw. For like a split second, it'll show up there in the loop of video because the URL is actually Celine Dion. But I had no idea. Anyway, to show you this, we pride ourselves at Condé Nast on being the amazing cultural impact for over 100 years to, of course, fashion, also technology, food, architecture, crazy things like golf. We want to every day, from a technology and engineering perspective, be building more and building better. And we've been on a multi-year long project to build what some might consider an ivory tower. Some might, myself included, consider this to be a shooting for the moon if you land, sorry, like shooting for the stars if you land on the moon, that's okay. We have been working for about 3 years, and this project just finished a month and a half ago, to move 22 plus different sites on drastically different CMSs. We've had many WordPress, completely custom. We've had many, I don't know if people have even heard of TeamSite, CQ5. Anyone heard of these like weird CMSs? Okay. So there's actually way more than WordPress, Squarespace, Wix, and a couple of the competitors out there. And as large companies have been around for over 100 years can attest, with time comes accumulation of technology, and we have had everything under the goddamn sun. So, in the past 4 years, approximately, I should find that exact month out, because I realize I've been changing it. Somewhere between 3 and 4 years, we have been building the largest technical project that the engineering and technology team has been building at Confluence. It has been to consolidate all of our content management as well as all of our front-end brand websites like GQ.com, Vogue.com, VanityFair.com onto one single technical platform. This was the it was considered for a long time to never actually be able to be completed, and we just did this and we're very proud of it. Now, what this means for us in terms of the technology perspective is that we have a lot of opportunities. But let me step a little bit back and tell you what the detail is and what it took to get there. So we had to go through migrations galore. Because for each of these 22 different systems, for all I know, they all had different WordPress plugins, and they all had different customizations where really there were 9 different title fields, and title 1 meant author in some brands, but title 17 meant author in another one. So over these 4 years, the reason why it took us that long, and that it wasn't just dumping some table in SQL and doing some conversion, it took us a very long time and a lot of engineering effort and very intelligent people's work to come up with what we now call Copilot. Copilot is this one single system that we are pushing forward with. We actually just recently made very significant partnerships with other companies to start to use our internal product Copilot, intended to eventually maybe even like sell this outside. Many of you are looking for another CMS, please get in touch. So what did we get for all of this immense effort? We were able to make something that was not easy. We are uniform now. And being uniform gives us some huge advantages. It allows us to now take the approach of thinking about our technical problems, especially our goals for the web platform, thinking about it holistically, instead of thinking, well, Vogue really wants this right now, and GQ, that's going to take years to build for GQ. Or, well, Vanity Fair there's a Met Gala, some big fashion event right now, so we have to spend all of this time building this super custom thing for one of our brands, but we have no possible chance of actually being able to copy-paste that code everywhere else. So this uniformity has been very helpful for our product and our teams to coalesce around building shared, usable, effective software that we can quickly deploy across all of our brands. Because, so this is all from a technical perspective, right? From the brand perspective, some people don't even know that Vogue, GQ, and Wired, and ours are owned by the same company. But now that we have this technical ability, we are all, from the newest engineer up to the CTO, ridiculously excited about the potential for this platform. And all of this, I want to stress here, comes from the uniformity that we did all the work to achieve. So, we are on one platform. We started on the conversions to HTTPS. Gratefully, this is fairly easy. Our HTTPS product manager here is in the back, super excited about this. We will have all of our sites on HTTPS, using HTTPS in the next couple months, which was, again, like a years and years long project. Once you're on the same platform, things like this become pretty relatively easy. Gratefully, our infrastructure and our people were all on board, so this is just switches to flip now. So what this means for us, that about 2 months ago, we were able to open up a whole new category of interesting engineering effort and spend on things that were not explicitly for one brand, but rather we could spend our time thinking about and building solutions that work for everyone. Now, this is PWA again. We just did all this work to do HTTPS. Why did we do all of that? Because we plan on hitting this race running. We are planning on working on Wired. So Wired is our first use case for building out progressive web applications. It's our first, by far, beat everyone else with respect to HTTPS. In case any of you are interested, I think Mariko talked a lot about HTTPS this morning. Over a year ago, Wired actually switched to HTTPS. It has one of the probably the longest, also the most helpful and detailed technical approach article as to how they moved a large publication with a lot of SEO concerns from HTTP to HTTPS, including HSTS, that's what it's described this morning. So we are here at the starting line. We have a lot of research to do. So all of our time, all of was spent for weeks and weeks, sitting with all of the amazing resources that Google and many others have provided online. So you've already done things like the code labs. There are gratefully many, many more. This eventually I'll send my slides around. This happens to be a very all-encompassing training. I think they also have it all on YouTube. We spent a lot of time digging into the API. And for us, digging into the API, I think as you've seen today, these particular features, when we first jumped out of that airplane, we were thinking, okay, so there's a couple technologies. There's service worker, there's manifest, there's cache, there's push manager, there's all these different names for APIs. And at least from my perspective, this is complicated, this is documented, there is detail here. This is very similar, though, to the process of learning any new technology. So when Angular 19 comes out, you're going to have to learn that. When React isn't cool and you're working with Recoil, which is so much better in like 2022, you know you'll have to learn that too. So what? So the process for us of learning the technologies, as you just experienced in the code labs here today, it's not easy, but it's also not extremely complicated. You will learn this. You will read these articles. You will try these things, and I have full confidence we did and we continue will to learn these things. But there's a little bit of a difference here with respect to I am now learning Angular 19, or I really want to learn React and create React app makes that super easy because I am able to make a new project using this great new technology from scratch easily. And mainly, this is for a couple of reasons. One, we at Condé Nast just spent years coming to the same unique platform. We do not currently anymore have the luxury of rewriting. Now, my personal opinion is that I would never take that luxury even if it were there. But rewriting is always in the back of all of our heads because it always seems easier, right? It always seems easier if I can just throw away my entire code base, RMRF, and start using Create React App because that's like the coolest thing in the world right now. But then 4 years later, 2 years later, however many months later, you will want to do that again. And we are confronting that exact same problem. We just did. So there is some, with respect to the current landscape of PWA architectures. But what I didn't mention here is the app shell model. The app shell model fits really well for single page applications. And I think so, I asked you all to raise your hand originally because I was wondering, because I assume in lots of these rooms, especially the super JavaScript heavy ones, is that everyone on earth is writing single page applications using React or Angular or even Ember, because I think they're kind of cool too. But really we're not. There are lots of people, lots of intelligent brains in a world where, no, you can't just use the coolest thing because there's actual work to do and revenue to make on existing software. So the things that I have found, so also, with respect to the tooling around PWAs, the PWA technologies themselves, you can read the docs, you will read the code, you will do more of the code labs, and it will become very clear that when you are writing from scratch, you can use all of these techniques to successfully build progressive web applications. But, and I have felt this way since starting to read more about caching and workbox, as you heard this morning. There are other names for tools that have changed over the past couple of months. As you Google for this, you will find more than workbox. And use workbox, though, it is the best out of them. But if you Google enough, you will eventually see that workbox didn't exist a couple months ago, or not in the way it is now, and that there are many competing low-level libraries for this. And as I and my team started to build these things, I felt way more like I was being given a shovel, told to dig a hole to China. And all I was doing was looking at React App and Angular CLI and Ember CLI and even Rails. And I was just thinking, but I want that. I don't want the shovel. I really, really don't want the shovel because it's going to take me forever to individually understand how to correctly remove from cache one particular file because I have decided to update my logo or update some particular piece of my Appy experience, however that is. So this has been a difficulty. Another way that I'd like to say this, because I think it's funny, and I think it's actually probably more true because I've never, ever been told to dig a hole to China, is actually I feel like I've been given TCP and told make the web now. And I know technically, super technically, that is true, I could do that. But no one would do that. No one would want to spend the time and effort to make all of the amazing things that we have because of the web with something so low level as an individual shovel and TCP connections. So, I want to talk a little bit about nuance. So, a lot of progressive web applications and a lot of the think pieces by thought leaders and a lot of the individual opinions you will hear about names or otherwise, even my own somewhat pedantic opinions that you will hear through all of this, take all of this with a grain of salt. As you are learning this, as anything worthwhile, it will be difficult, but it will be very fulfilling in the end. So the word progressive web applications, and I think depending on how often you talk to business and product, you might or might not find that this is true, is somewhat of a buzzword, right? That's why XYZ camps work, because it's something people want to hear about. There's actually a great blog post that I link here, I forget who wrote it, talking about how PWAs are just a marketing term, and realistically, amongst the programmers here, we should just say the specific technologies like service worker or the cache or the manifest or something, because PWA as a category becomes really confusing, especially when you live in a world like I do, where we don't particularly want an app experience. We are a website where people read content, and in terms of what we would, even if we had all the money in the world, we wouldn't be making native applications for all of our sites. That's not how people want to necessarily even interact with us. That's not how social works. That's not our revenue model. That's just not how, we don't, even if we could, we wouldn't want native apps for everything. As this is being recorded, I should say I do not stand for all of the opinions of my company. So there's tons of nuance here, and I'll go into a little bit more of my opinion. So there is tons of talk and thoughts of slick modern tech, right? Like there is so much stuff and assumptions depending on what subculture within the community of software engineering you live in. And right now I feel like client-side rendering and single-page web applications, this is the hottest, newest kid on the block. This is the fidget spinner, which by the way, came out of nowhere for me. I didn't even know this. This was maybe like a month ago, and I saw this. Oh, I went to the Empire State Building. My cousin from out of town, I don't actually like go there all the time, decided to come to New York and said he's never gone to see the Empire State Building, so he really had to go, and I was like, really? You want me to wait in that line? He's like, yes, we have to go. And his wife was like, well, you've never been? It was crazy, they have to go. Okay. So I went to the Empire State Building, got you get in line, and the ticket taker person is standing there with one hand fidget spinner, and other hand taking tickets. And I'm just like, it's real? This is what happened. And then okay, so I get the ticket there, and then you see a security guard. No. Security guard fidget spinner. And like, I just hope that he keeps his mind on the other things too. I didn't know. So for me, and I think that everyone has this moment in programming, regardless of how long they've been doing it, at some point you realize, oh, that thing I've been spending a lot of time on is not even cool anymore. Now, and I totally understand why that happened. I myself love being a fanboy of tons of things. But for me, understanding all of the different concerns and stakeholders for the technical goals I have, it's hard for me to validly say, yeah, let's rewrite our whole project. for PWA. It's a good common single page rental application. And things, and I should probably, I don't think that I'm particularly calling anyone out on this. So there was this article written not so long ago about called before you build a PWA, you need a single page application. These are the kinds of things I want to let you all know. It's not necessarily, it's difficult to understand, and I will talk more about this, but that's not true. We can't necessarily have all the cake, but we can have a good amount of cake without rewriting all of our projects. And we can have a good amount of tasty things without having to be using the newest, hottest technology. So for me, what I would call an alien web app, and this is what I feel like we are building right now. They're not progressive because they don't map exactly to what the checklist of items are. It's using some PWA features. It's an application that is server-side rendered, not client-side rendered, and it's not particularly accurate. So we are not. As much as I want to switch and say that we are not happy at all. So, and then I'm very honest in the belief that Condé Nast is not the only company that has this goal. There are more, and I think there will be more, effective uses of progressive web app technology that do not directly map to everything, the list of what it means to be a PWA. And that's not a bad thing. So I'm going to talk you through a little bit of what I would consider so far the lowest hanging fruit as to what I know, what we have built some and what we will continue to build that does not fit the category exactly, but is still helpful for us. And some of these things I'm sure. So the first one is static asset caching with Service Worker. This is somewhat out of the box with all of the tools. It does not necessarily move performance needles immensely, but it is something that you can do fairly easily, and it does not matter if you already have a single page application or an app shell in place. This is the first thing we are doing, and we are in the process of having enough tooling to be able to check our performance differences automatically. And when we do that, next time I will tell you exactly how much better or not, well, definitely better, slightly, than the current performance we have is. The next one is something called AMP Install Service Worker. So how many of you, how many of you work for like publication events? So how many of you know what AMP is? AMP is this, I actually don't know the formal marketing material for AMP. AMP is a technology provided by Google, as well as a particular group of servers that will host your data for you, but it is a technology to make extremely fast mobile pages. AMP stands for Accelerated Mobile Pages. Using AMP Install Service Worker, you can actually, if you've ever seen a Google on a mobile device, there is that really fancy carousel at the top. So sometimes when you search for Trump or something, at the top there'll be images that load super quickly when you tap on them. All of those are AMP articles. For Condé, it is very important to be in that carousel because it means that people are much more likely to read our stuff and click on our stuff. Using AMP Install Service Worker, which is a plugin for AMP, we can actually have Google and the browser install the Service Worker in the background for our domains. So even if someone has just read a single GQ article on using AMP while they clicked on that carousel, in the background we can preload all of GQ, or we can preload all of the GQ images, or the shell that's needed technically. So that is the next thing we're going to approach. And that is intended to, and we'll get performance information to be more metric-driven about this, it's intended to significantly speed up their first interaction with the real domain after visiting an AMP page. And then to go along with the previous talk, another fairly low-hanging fruit for us, even without completely rewriting our app, is an offline page. Like down with the demo store, we can actually allow our rich designers and product people to think through how exactly we should be presenting ourselves when we are offline. This is something that is actually fairly low-hanging fruit anyway, regardless of SDA or silver-side rendered or not. And something that I think that all of the cases that were made previously today about how easy and great it is when you don't have the you are not connected to the internet message. I am very excited to see that across the board. In terms of exact metrics that is going to live, I don't think it's necessarily going to give us a lot of revenue directly, but the user engagement that we can drive by having people not feel like they have been cut off from us, I'm really excited about seeing. Similarly, add to home screen does not require any current changes to any significant changes to our entire systems. And also, lastly, push notifications. This is something that is super exciting for us because as a content publication and as a brand who has a lot of information about their users' preferences, desires, and like what content they engage with, we can know very precisely, along with the immense power and intelligence of our data science team, and actually a completely custom, like super crazy machine that's like physically in our office. Should come by and visit sometime. It's like 19 GPUs or something. I don't know exactly what it does, but our data science people do a lot of really cool things with it. So we are in the process of also building out integrations with third-party providers that allow us to use push notifications on a user-by-user basis to be able to, in the ideal case, know exactly what someone will want to read, such that we can guarantee that they actually click on it, because we don't want to send them irrelevant things. There's actually a lot of Google material and otherwise about all of the product thinking that goes into what makes a good push notification. This is not as simple as, that's cool, you should send me. as I would think. So we are currently doing some POCs, some actual production work. A lot of the production work is being done with Wired. We are pushing really hard and fast to get this actually into production because one of the biggest reasons as to why we went on HTTPS is to be able to get as much of the performance benefit and user engagement benefit out of progressive web app technologies as possible. We are also currently experimenting a lot in our blog. Our technology blog is actually using the same awesome platform as I was talking about earlier. So we actually are dogfooding with respect to that. So our CMS that powers GQ.com, the exact same production install, is also powering our technology blog. So all of these features, like push notifications, like add to home screen, like our work on with service workers and static asset caching, all of this is being done directly in our blog first before we are moving the modules and components that we are writing into the brand applications, and with the focus and eye on making sure that that is easy, seamless, and pie in the sky perfect. Let's see how that goes. So we actually also have a blog post in case any of you are interested. We just released this about the move of W Magazine to HTTPS. There's a lot of learning that the specific team members who worked on moving this particular brand over have learned about, most saliently working with SEO, because SEO for publications, SEO and Google search is just immensely important to actually make a business work. Also, and I think you might have heard this mentioned a little earlier, my colleague Gotham, who did one of the code labs, opened up this thing called Weather PWN. So another difficulty we've had, and you might as you go through this, is when you are starting to work with PWAs, knowing what tooling is appropriate for your particular unique snowflake of a build process is difficult. Because if you use Gulp, it's different than if you use Webpack. It's different than if you don't use either because you're using NPM scripts. Or because you're using, I don't know, Rake. So there are many different options for how you can integrate the Workbox tooling and all of the other tooling into your application, and they are not yet the most straightforward. This particular demo and application, if you read through weatherpwa.com, which is also a glitch application, it'll be much clearer and has very clear examples for how you can go about doing this. All of those examples were sort of extracted from all of our internal work on the tech blog. So there's a lot of really good things coming with respect to Condé Nast efforts to find the right way to, without feeling happy, without necessarily being client-side rendered, make a progressive web application. We will make this alien web application into a thing. So I'm John Paul. You can find me on the internet there. In terms of like any actual communication, if you npm install me, it will show you everything you need to know. And then if you like figure out how that works, it's pretty cool. So I'm on the architecture team at Condé Nast. Excited to be talking to all of you, be able to have this opportunity to talk about the great things we are doing and how we want to be doing more, and I'm sure all of you do as well. Thank you so much. Slide, but then as soon as you go read what I did, you'll be like, oh, that's kind of cool.
What remains to be solved at Condé Nast? Looks like you've got it all figured out.
Oh, no, not at all. So the question was, what remains to be solved at Condé Nast? You seem like you've got it all figured out. No, this is all just fake. So in terms of progressive web application, there's actually a lot, because the list of things that I showed you as low-hanging fruit for publications is nowhere near the actual list of progressive web applications. So the most salient next step for us after all of this is implemented, so there's actually two of them. One is figuring out the right way to take these learnings and apply them to all of the brand. But as I was saying earlier, finding that perfect abstraction of component that like actually can be immediately deployed across everything, that requires work. Finding a way to use things that are more complicated. Like I'd love to get us to the abstract model. The abstract model, if we were a client-side application, it would be an abstract model tomorrow. But that is difficult because we don't have a client-side router, for example. We don't do any of that yet. Right now, it's a backend application that sends HTML. Also, in terms of, I guess if you mean more generically, there's a lot of work we're doing as to how to build plugins into our CMS, how we can bring the sort of advertisement and metric-driven things into our CMS. There's a lot more work to do. Progressive web application is just one line.
So,
and
for me, it's kind of a controversial thing, at least
internally,
like, you know, ties to Google ranking and all that. And I'm wondering, like, was your rationale to go with AMP?